Welcome to the Thursday episode of the Poker Gossip Show. I'm your host, Jeff Walsh. Thanks so much for joining me. We are right around 8 p.m. Pacific Standard Time here in the heart of beautiful downtown Palo Alto. What a wonderful day it was today. You know, when you get older like me, the weather just becomes more and more important. I'm here in the hallowed halls of the Run Good Studios, and it's Thursday, so I'm going to keep it loose. You know, I've been scolded by Marco, who you might know here from Quad Jax. He does the gaming world, the news, for sometimes beating myself up a little bit. So I decided today, well, I didn't decide this because of that, but I decided I was going to tell a story today to start this off, because part of the show is kind of about me. Like, I'm really nobody. I'm a grinder like you. I play tournaments. I play cash. I'm trying to get better. I'm like you. I'm not like the big stars that we have coming on the show. So part of the show happens to be about me and kind of like who I am. So anyway, something kind of funny happened today, and I'm going to tell you a little story with no point. I hope you enjoy it. If this isn't something you want to listen to, if you're listening on a podcast, all you need to do is fast forward 15 minutes, and I'm going to be joined by my first guest, John Friedberg. He's going to be here on the show in about 15 minutes. So just cut all this right out, jump to the 15-minute mark, and you don't have to listen to any of this. So as you may or may not know from just listening to any number of episodes from this show, maybe one of the most important entities in my life outside of my family is my pup. I have a French bulldog pup, Chloe. Sometimes Zach calls her Clowny or Clony, but it's not. It's Chloe, and she's super important to me, and every day, almost every day, we go to the dog park. This is all going to wrap into, I don't know if it's going to wrap, but anyway, we go to the dog park, right? A lot of owners go to the dog park. Well, ever since Chloe was a super small pup, I've been going. So I go at the same time, just about 4 to 5 times a week. So I'm well known, not like my personality, but I'm the guy with the French bulldog. And while I'm a motherfucking affable dude, like, we can talk, and I talk at the poker table all the time, and people seem to get along with me, and I really enjoy getting to know people. At the dog park, I'm just straight up here to make sure that everything's okay with Chloe. So I don't really do a lot of socializing. I'm not the guy on the bench doing that stuff. I stand there with my glasses on. I usually have my black North Face jacket on, and I just stare and I watch, make sure she doesn't get in any trouble. Let her have her time. Okay, so I'm just setting that up so the fact that is – well, people know me. They don't know my personality. They don't know whether I'm a nice guy or a jerk or whatever. So, as you might know, whether you're a parent or a parent of a dog, you kind of get to have these relationships with other people, even if it's just like a head nod. Like, yeah, I got a dog and you got a dog, and we're here at the same time all the time, right? So Chloe makes her own relationships with other dogs. And there's another dog that she happens to have befriended. And they're the same age, and for years they were friends together. So that, of course, makes it so that owner talks to me. He's not a bad guy, but he's a bit of a tough guy. And I don't know if you know this out there, but I'm going to speak a truth. Hey, tough guys, just letting you know, no one likes a tough guy. Like, no one likes a tough guy. Tough guys are not liked. You're not necessarily feared. It's just nobody likes you. Because nobody wants that kind of attitude. Nobody wants that kind of harassment in their life. Anyway, he's a bit of a tough guy, but it's not that I don't like him as much as, you know, he can be a little bit off-putting. But we sit there and we talk, and like I said, I'm an affable dude, so I can make conversation, and I do. His dog can get a little rough. Man, now I'm way deep in this. I'm way deeper than I wanted to be. His dog can get a little rough, and another dog can get a little rough. And they start playing rough. And all of a sudden, it looks like these dogs are going to fight, but they're definitely not fighting. And the two owners of these dogs don't even care. And this guy comes streaking across the room. Not the room, you know, the play area. He's like, hey, 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 break it up. And he separates the French bulldog, not mine, but this other one. And he separates this other kind of collie. And he's like, and you know, like he's really like pumped up, like he's done something here. He's like the hero of the day. He's jumping in here. And the guy right next to me is like, hey, man, don't worry about it. Like, my dog is not going to do anything. My dog is not going to bite this guy. And he reaches over and goes, hey, man, why don't you watch your dog a little closer? He started a fight over here. And like I said, the guy next to me, he's a tough guy. So he's like, hey, man. He just goes straight from that to, hey, man, why don't you fucking fuck off? Because I know my dog. He goes, why don't you know your dog better? Your dog started a fight. And just these two alpha male, these two dogs come walking right up to each other. These guys just like, hey, fuck you. No, no, no. F you. F you. I should really cut the language back just in case. But these guys just start F, you know, F you, F you, F you. And they put right up each other and start bumping chests like, oh, they're tough guys at the dog park. Just two tough guys at the dog park. And I look around and I realize it's these two tough guys with their dogs, a bunch of oldies, and me. The group that comes out at this time happens to be a bunch of old people. Now, I live pretty much near a retirement home. I love me some old people. They're like nice, you know what I mean? They're almost always super nice, even when they're cranky. And so I can just see this look of terror on this group of regulars. They're looking at what's going on. They're worried, but then I also start to notice they're looking at me. They're looking at me like I'm going to do something about this. I'm like, yeah, one guy is really big, really strong. And then the other guy is tough guy who's, you know, he's buffer and he, you know, shorter. And you haven't seen me. I haven't been on camera very much, but I'm not exactly what you'd call tough guy. You know, average, low end of athletic without being overweight. But nonetheless, I look like the next youngest person who's going to do something here. So of course they get so close and they bump their chests and they're spitting in each other's faces and they're just swearing out words, and all the dogs are starting to get nervous and all the oldies are really getting nervous and they're looking at me and I'm like, oh boy. Yeah, something's gonna happen here. Am I supposed to step in here? Am I supposed to step in right here? So anyway, long story short, of course, one guy shoves the other guy, then the other guy, and now they're going to get into a fist fight, and you could hear like the rumbling of the oldies. They're like, oh my God, what's going to happen? And I'm literally sitting there going, oh boy, hands in my pocket. Like, I got to do something about this. I guess, like, what am I going to do? I'm not a tough guy. Can you tell by my voice? Yeah, I'm old enough, but I don't have this surly, raspy voice of, yeah, I'm going to take care of this shit. No, 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 no. I'm Jeff Walsh, man boy. You know what I'm saying? My face is far too pretty to take a punch to, especially at age 40. So fuck this shit. I am not going to get involved here. But obviously, I've got to get involved here because they start pushing each other around the dog park. So I do. So finally, I kind of creep up. And then one guy gives another guy a really good push. And I just kind of slightly step in there and go, hey, good game, guys. That's what I say. I go, good game. And then they're swearing and yelling. At the same time, this is why I said I don't really want to tell this part of the story, because maybe this could make me look good, but, you know, I mean, I'm pretty much a chicken, but okay. You know, I like to be honest about that. These two guys calm down, and one of the oldies turns around and he goes to leave. He doesn't want to leave, but I mean, he wants to leave, so he's leaving, and his own dog trips him. Now, this guy's name is Lou. He's like a sweetheart. And I didn't know it at the time that his name was Lou. But he takes a fall. He's falling towards a trash can. And I just happened to be like right there, right as the fight was broken up. So I turn around, lucky, I just reach down. And I wish I could have caught him better. You know what I mean? I kind of catch him. But he takes a really bad tumble, which is you know, nobody likes to fall like that. And he's an older guy. So he looks up at me. I wanted to say thank you for stopping the fight. Like, yeah. I didn't stop anything, but thank you. You know what I mean? So I pick him up and I send him on his way. The reason I tell that story is just so I can get to this part, which is, first of all, that's kind of a funny story in its own right, where these guys are going to start a fight at the dog park and stupid me has to step in the middle. And I do. And neither one of those two guys ever came back after that day because I'm still a regular. But because of that, now all the oldies love me. I come walking in, and it's no longer, they don't leave me alone anymore. to just be there and watch Chloe. They all come up to me. They say, hello, how's Chloe? And Lou, who is the sweetest guy, he's in his deep 80s and he's sharp as a tack. He always gets up. He looks kind of like a godfather. He wears a Kangol and he's got a gold chain. And he's wearing a jumpsuit. He always comes up and shakes my hand, and he's such a nice guy. The reason I get to that is this is the only reason I get the chance to talk to Lou. Plus, I like to tell that story about the dogfighting. People seem to like it. We're talking about stuff today, and we're talking about the Giants. The Giants had a big win against the Phillies yesterday, and even though it's early in the season, you know, like we Giants fans thought it was a pretty great game. We start talking about baseball, and he starts talking about, well, you know, as a young man, I was a gambler. And I'm like, I knew I liked this guy for a reason. I was a gambler, and I used to gamble on these on baseball games. Tough racket. And I remember this one time where I bet on the White Sox, this pitcher. He got hit in the face with a ball when he was with the Yankees, and then the Yankees released him. And then he was going to pitch against the Yankees, and the Yankees at the time, this is the 1960s, they were this huge, you know, this huge favorite, and I gave the guy a run plus the tie. I go, okay, so he gave him the run and the push. He's like, I gave him the run and the push, and I won that bet. I had bet $500 on it. I went, wow, that's a big bet. He's like, yeah, $500 in 1950. So I go, whoa, that's a huge bet for 1950. And I say, well, look, you know, I don't know that much about gambling, but I know a little bit about poker, and I don't get into it. I'm like, but, you know, I play on my own time, on my time, my spare time, when I'm not working, etc. And this other guy, this other super old guy, and I don't mean that offensively, but Lou is in his deep 80s, right? He's like 85, maybe later. But he's super sharp. And then Bill comes up, and Bill's kind of like a, I think he's a Eastern European guy, like Croatia, or did I just say that? I don't even know. He's a Eastern European guy. He's got a great accent. And Lou, 85, 88-year-old Lou goes, I play poker. I said, oh, do you? He's like, I got $4 million. I said, what? He's like, I got $4 million. I play online. I said, you play like Zynga online? He's like, I play on PokerStars, and I got $4 million. Let me tell you something. I started out with $20,000. I said, now you're talking about fake money. He's like, oh, yeah, totally fake. But I got $4 million. I built it up. And the other guy, Bill, who's in his 60s, like, yes, I play on there too. I got these two oldies, and they're both playing home games. They're playing play money chips on PokerStars, and now they're going to impart some poker wisdom on me. And it was outstanding. Lou launches in. I started with $20,000, and I built it up. I'll tell you what, young one, I'm aggressive. I get in there, and I like to stick it all in the middle. And people won't call, but sometimes they call, but sometimes they don't call. And I'll tell you what I learned. I fold aces, not two of them, of course, but I'll fold an ace six. And the other guy goes, I see this guy on TV. You know, these kids, they are so young. They do these things. There's this guy, David Peter. And I go, I don't know David Peter. He's like, he's this weird looking guy. He plays. I go, are you talking about Viffer, weird guy. And he takes these hands and he plays with nothing. He's got nothing. And he takes people off of aces or ace four. He does this. And it's crazy how they play. These kids today, Lou jumps in. These kids, they are so smart. And do you see this kid who won this time? And then now they're talking, and I'm just listening to the two old guys talk. He goes, do you watch the World Series of Poker? And then the other guy's, oh, I love the World Series of Poker. And I just don't know how this happens, guys. Like, these two super oldies, both sweethearts, right? And they've got great dogs, and I really like hanging out with them. Poker's everywhere, man. Poker is everywhere. You don't even know who you're going to run into who's playing poker. My man, Lou, in his deep 80s, and he said such a truth when he said it. He said, I started playing poker on PokerStars 2 years ago. I started playing in the play chips, and I love it. but you know who hates it? My wife. And I said, yeah, man. Everybody's wife hates poker. Don't you know that? Like I said, it's a story without a point. I just wanted you to know that there's good people out there. They're still grinding the Poker Stars. They're still grinding the play session at Poker Stars. And my man Lou takes his $4 million in play money as serious business. He says, I play that like it's real money. And my dream one day, God bless him, my dream one day is to make it out to the World Series of Poker. I want to play real poker with real people in Las Vegas. And I said, my man, you just keep playing that those play chips, and I have no doubt that one day you'll find yourself out there, because this guy, while he might be old, he's sharp as shit. I want to thank you guys for listening to me bullshit. Like I said, 8:15, we're going to have our first guest. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to be right back with John Friedberg, Poker Gossip Show, right here on Quadjax. I was a little long-winded, so my apologies. Sometimes I get into it. Anyway, hey, my next guest is a 2006 bracelet winner. He's got over $1 million in lifetime live earnings on the circuit. Not only is he a passionate poker player, but he's also passionate about poker media and covering it as well. He was one of the co-hosts of the legendary online poker show, The Circuit, and now he's currently involved with All Vegas Poker. Welcome to John Friedberg to the show. John, how are you tonight?
Good, Jeff. How are you?
I'm doing very well. Hey, thanks so much for joining us. I'm really excited to have you. John, the WSOP is right around the corner. I bet you know it. I know you're there, or you're going to be there. Can you still feel the thrill of winning your bracelet from 2006?
Yes. It's still pretty surreal, even though it was like 38 years ago already, it seems like. I hope I can have that opportunity again. It's an amazing feeling.
Once you've gotten that, because it looked like I was reading your bio, and I know that you have an extensive background in business, and I'm definitely going to ask you all about that. But you're in the business world. You fall in love with poker. And it didn't look like too long afterwards that you were at the WSOP grinding, and you grinded out that victory. Did that happen early in your poker career, or where was it in your lifetime poker career?
You know, it was kind of in an interesting place. I started playing poker when I was 18 at the local Indian casino in Tucson, where I went to college. And I'm, 37 now, so that was about 19 years ago when I started playing.
Wow.
Always loved poker, but never really had the time. Well, I played a lot in college, but in 2004, I moved to Vegas and started playing poker a little more seriously, spending a lot more time doing it. Played in a couple of events. I think I won like an Aruba seat. I won a PCA seat.
Oh, cool.
So I played in some big events, but didn't really have too much experience. In 2006, I sort of was able to get lucky in a big field and win a tournament. And that was kind of the start of my real sort of traveling professional career in poker. At that point, I decided I was going to travel around and play the major tournament circuit. And I did that for about 3 or 4 years or so.
Yeah.
And now, as you know, I still play a little bit of poker, but for the most part, I'm a lot more focused on business.
So let's talk a little bit about traveling the poker circuit. You had a big win. I think that it was $500K plus, right? It was $500,000 plus.
Right.
And in that picture, just a little aside, what two cards are you holding? Is that an 8-deuce you're holding, or is that ace-8? what are you holding there?
No, it was an ace-7 of hearts, I believe.
Oh, okay. All right. Yes. Ace-7 of hearts. That's such a great picture. You could go to johnfriedberg.com, and it's the main picture on your homepage. Man, you look – I don't know if I've ever seen a happier poker winner than you right then and there, right?
Yeah, I mean, I cannot think of a happier day in my life, to be honest, and I don't know that I'll ever have one, but hopefully. We'll see.
So, obviously, traveling the circuit is both – not is expensive, not just in your time and as well as your brain space, but obviously the money. What were those 2 to 3 years like after you had won that and decided you're going to take a legitimate shot at this?
So it was I had already kind of been playing poker full-time for a couple of years, So I wasn't really transitioning much in my lifestyle. I was more just shifting from kind of playing, you know, a lot of smaller tournaments online and a little bit of live cash games. Transitioning from that to traveling around and playing in all the, you know, the 10K buy-ins and whatnot. Right. Yeah, like you said, it's fun, but it's a lot of work and it really, really wears you out. And like you said, it's very expensive. If I remember right, I was averaging about $300,000 in buy-ins and travel expenses a year. And, you know, again, it's a lot of fun. You see a lot of the same people at the events, obviously lots of, you know, late nights and fun times and whatnot. But yeah, ultimately, when you put it in the grand scheme of things, winning $500,000 and then having a $300,000 annual tournament and travel budget, it's really not a lot of money.
100%. I was going to say that that's something that kind of gets overlooked when you think about the same people that you see time and time again at the WPTs, obviously grinding a lot of the WSOPs out, is that the buy-ins are just astronomical. And on top of that, the travel time, the wear and tear on your mind and body, while it sounds like the baller lifestyle, man, it sounds like it's also quite the grind. And is that what made you stop doing that? Like what was it in your life that made you go outside of, or maybe it was the expense that says, I'm going to get off the circuit here.
Right. Well, I think there were a few factors. One of them was that, you know, the poker industry itself, maybe not the poker industry, but like the high buy-in professional poker circuit in the U.S., the prize pool or the fields were getting a lot smaller. The fields were getting a lot tougher. And, you know, just after, you know, staying in a couple of different hotels, a couple of different cities every month, traveling all around, it really just kind of burnt me out. And it kind of got to the point where I'm sure every tournament player has had this feeling at least once where I kind of started to feel like I was chasing my tail a little bit. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot of times where, you know, somebody will win, like, you know, somebody who's playing in these 10K events, they'll win 50,000. You know, maybe you finish, whatever, 9th, 10th place or something, and, you know, you win 50,000 in a 10K buy-in. Sounds like a lot of money. It's more money than a lot of people make in a year. But, you know, when you think about reinvesting that in poker tournaments, it's like another, you know, 2 months or so of you know, playing in events. But basically, I just kind of felt like, you know, I felt like I accomplished, you know, my number one lifetime goal in poker, which is to win a bracelet. And at that point, I just felt like, you know, I want to work towards a bigger prize. And I also want to do what I can to, you know, stay involved in poker and, you know, just, you know, business, the way I see it, is really like poker in itself, just on a larger scale. So yeah. I really just kind of got sick of, you know, traveling a lot and playing in these 10K events. And, you know, it just wears you down, especially tournament poker. You know, it's hard to win enough money. It's hard to cash often enough to compensate for the times when you don't cash. And I don't even mean financially. I mean just emotionally.
I can only imagine that you travel some far distance, and the fact of the matter is whether it's something right there in Vegas, or whether you go to Monte Carlo, like they're having the EPT in Monte Carlo, you could bust on the first hand. You could bust, you know, oh, well, maybe not that, but you know what I'm saying? Like, you could bust in the first hour if things go tragically wrong, or you think you're getting it in absolutely crushing and something, you know, you run into quads or something like that.
You know, running into quads is a good excuse. Most of my busts were, you know, most of the time I don't have that good of a story, but yeah, I mean, I can't tell you how many times I traveled to Foxwoods or Borgata for a 10K event. You know, it's a, you know, $500 airfare when you book it ahead of time. You know, 5-6 hours of travel each direction. You fly into Philadelphia, you have to take an hour shuttle to get to Borgata. Then you're paying $200 a night to stay there. Get there a couple days early so you can adjust to the time zone. The tournaments always started at, like, you know, 10 or 11 a.m. East Coast time, which is like, you know, 8 a.m. here, West Coast. Then you play in the event, you bust out 3 hours later, and, you know, now what? So now you have to check out of the hotel. get back on that, you know, hour shuttle back to Philadelphia, the 5.5 hour flight back here, which you now have to pay another $100 or $200 for because you have to change your travel plans last minute. So yeah, I mean, it's, I mean, don't get me wrong, I absolutely love tournament poker. I love poker, but yeah, just doing that so many times, it just wears you down. And, you know, ultimately I got to the point where I thought, you know, I'm just going to focus my poker career in Las Vegas. There's plenty of action here. I'm going to travel to some of the events that are in closer proximity, such as Los Angeles and obviously some here, and just, you know, not spend so much time on the road because, yeah, it's a lot of time invested to get somewhere. And more often than not, it doesn't result in, you know, in any success.
I'm gonna bring us into the present and the future in just a second. I got one more question. I'm gonna put you on the spot a little bit about your past. Here now, you won the bracelet in 2006. Here we are in 2012. Looking back, how was your game in 2006? Did you just run god awful good, or are you just as good today as you were that day? Assess your skill level having won a bracelet at that time.
That's a great question. I would say in 2004, 5, and 6, I was way ahead of the curve in terms of my poker game relative to the field. I've considered myself to be a huge favorite. I still felt that in 07, I was a favorite over the field. But by 2008 and 2009, I felt like I had gotten passed up tremendously. You know, having a lot of success in the 06, 07 timeframe, you know, I spent a lot more, I just didn't really have the patience as much for grinding these $100 buy-ins online. And I just spent more time traveling and having fun. And, you know, the game sort of passed me up a little bit. In 2010, I basically had to relearn the game. And I did some pretty extensive training. In fact, with one of the Quad Jacks show hosts, Mr. Nikolak, John Kim.
Oh, we just had him on Tuesday. He was a guest of ours.
Yeah, so John and I are pretty good friends, and I worked with him a lot in 2010, retooled my entire game, and I was, you know, crushing 2010, 2011 until Black Friday. And then since then, you know, I haven't played a whole lot of poker since Black Friday, but, you know, John really taught me a lot about, you know, just sort of trained my mind a little bit differently. Not only John, by the way, another guy, Benton Blakeman, who I don't know if you've had on the show or not, but Benton, working with John and Benton really sort of helped me see poker in a different perspective, made me think differently. And now I feel that I'm much more equipped to adapt to whatever game I'm in. Whereas prior to working with John and Benton, I had more of sort of a, you know, a machine approach to it. I just had my own sort of way of playing. Mm-hmm. But now I, you know, so yeah, to answer your question, I felt like I was, you know, in hindsight, I was, you know, definitely a top tier player until about 2007 or 8, got behind and then sort of, you know, relearned the game. But it's so important for poker players that want to take the game serious to really focus on learning as much as playing. Because once you feel like you don't have anything else to learn, everyone is going to pass you up. And it certainly happened to me, and I've seen it happen to a lot of people.
John, now we've talked a little bit about, you have an extensive background in business. Did you have a school, your education in business, is that right?
Yeah, I have a bachelor's in finance and an MBA, a master's in business.
And you've taken that, plus your love of poker, and you're kind of in the business of poker right now. So I'm just curious, as an overall, I know we're in post-Black Friday, 1 year later. What's the current state of the business of poker in your estimation?
I think, you know, that's a little bit of a tricky question because I feel like we're right on the cusp of online poker, you know, getting legalized on a large scale here in the U.S., mm-hmm. And I think that's going to have a significant impact. Personally, I feel like it's going to create the glory days all over again. I feel like we're going to relive the 2003, 2004, you know, I feel like we're going to sort of relive those days again. So the poker business, I mean, it's blossoming. You know, there's casinos popping up all over Florida. you know, all these places. Vegas itself, I think, might be hurting a little bit as a result. But overall, I'd say the poker business is it's doing well. I think a lot of the card rooms have good traffic. I think they're making money. The professional poker circuit has trimmed down. There's not as much amateur money entering these events, and there's a lot more pros that are good that than what used to be. But I think for the people that play high stakes, I think it probably seems like poker is nothing what it used to be. But I think from an overall poker revenue standpoint in the U.S., I would guess that it's probably continued to increase.
So you come off the circuit, take a little step back from playing. You learn how to play maybe a bit of a new style from Nikolak. Let me tell you something about John Kim, outstanding poker teacher, and his driving skills are less than ideal. I think we learned that this week.
Oh yeah, he's a terrible driver.
Terrible, terrible. And everybody go tweet at Nikolak Poker and say that we're bashing him on the air about his driving. But of course, All Vegas Poker is one of I think at least two websites that you have going. Can you tell us a little bit about it? Because I know that you're going to be getting a lot of traffic through people coming to Las Vegas this year for the WSOP.
Right. Yeah, so All Vegas Poker is it's a website. Of course, we also have a couple of mobile apps as well. But it's basically an online destination where poker enthusiasts can find out everything about every poker room in town, every tournament coming up, every cash game, and of course, other players' opinions on rooms and tournaments and things. So, you know, the one thing that I felt like was missing in the poker world when I was a player is if you want to find out what's going on, you know, there's not really any centralized information source on where to do that. And when the opportunity came across for me to get involved in All Vegas Poker, I jumped on it. And, AVP obviously is focused on the Las Vegas poker market. But we have since expanded. We recently acquired a larger site called thepokeratlas.com, mm-hmm. which has similar information, although not quite as in-depth as what we have on AVP. But the Poker Atlas covers a much broader geographic region. So if you're looking for comprehensive information on poker in Las Vegas, check out allvegaspoker.com. Or if you're looking for information on poker rooms or tournaments anywhere else, the Poker Atlas is the best place for that.
And is there a tour that goes along with that as well? Did you guys have live events?
You know, we do. What we're doing is the site and community, long before I got involved, had been running regular tournaments just where members of the community can get together and meet each other in person and play some poker. When I came on board, I decided to take that a little bit to the next level. So I started what we're calling the All Vegas Poker Tour, which is really just kind of what we were doing before, but on a slightly larger scale. We're partnering with a few poker rooms here in town and just having sort of a rotational circuit of events at different casinos. We just had our first event, our inaugural event at MGM Grand last month. Or I should say earlier this month, I guess.
Yeah.
And our second event is going to be at Caesar's Palace on May 19th and 20th. The buy-in is $350, and we're actually going to be the headline event of the Caesar's Palace WSOP warm-up series. And, not to promote this too much, but...
Yeah, that's okay. Go ahead. I mean,
Caesar's and the World Series of Poker are actually adding... $3,000 of World Series buy-ins to the prize pool.
Oh, wow.
So we're pretty excited. So yeah, to answer your question, we're running the All Vegas Poker Tour event. It's really just something that we want to have some fun with. We wanted to come up with some player-friendly tournaments that our community members and anybody else who likes poker can play in and have fun. And of course, we're webcasting all of the final tables on our website so people can play in front of the world to see.
You know what's nice about the radio show when we're talking about something like this, John, and just a bit of an aside, that when we're talking about promoting something, it's not like we're baseball show and we're trying to hawk tires. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, you know, you're selling candy to children. Of course, we're all poker players. So when you're saying, I don't want to promote too much, but you know, there's going to be $3,000 of overlay in this poker tournament. These guys don't mind. We don't mind.
Yeah, I guess you make a good point. Very good point.
Yeah. So we could talk about overlay and that stuff all day. So let's get into a little bit of the content of the site. And I want to know, because you're there in Vegas, right? So
yep.
There's going to be a large influx of people coming to the WSOP, some for their first time, some who have been there forever, and they're going to be coming to the site. They're going to check it out. I want to know, what do you recommend? What are your favorite rooms? Where now is where we don't want to sell. We want to give some exactly what we think. What do you think are the best rooms to play poker at? Where are the best places to stay? Your opinion, and maybe even the opinion of the people who are coming to the site.
Okay.
Whatever you can get. Yeah.
That's a good question.
Indeed.
You know, personally, when I play poker, I prefer to play. My favorite game is 5-10 no limit. Occasionally, I'll play 10-20 no limit. So, you know, unfortunately, that there's not too many rooms in town that spread those games. So personally, I'll generally play at the bigger rooms, the Aria, the Venetian, Bellagio, Wynn. Those are typically the games that spread the 5-10 and higher games that I tend to play in. But really, you know, I think most of the poker population likes to play 1-2 or even lower stakes limit hold'em. And, you know, I would say every room in town has 1-2 games for the most part. And really, it just depends on the player. I like to be in the, you know, the bigger, more crowded rooms. But, you know, other people, you know, like Las Vegas Michael, for example, who has been involved with AVP forever, he likes more of the smaller sort of older rooms that have more, you know, history behind them and whatnot. Mm-hmm. So it really just depends on you know, the player and you know, what they want. So, but there's so many nice rooms in town, you know, all of the popular rooms, you know, the biggest ones, Caesars, MGM, Venetian, etc. I would say, you know, they're all pretty similar. And of course, the games in this town are pretty much great across the board. Whether you're in a, you know, a 1-2 game at Bally's or, you know, a 5-10 game at Bellagio, the action here is great. It really is so good in this town. And plus the rake is also pretty low. A lot of people, you know, they're looking for, you know, lower rake rooms. And Vegas, you know, one of the things Vegas is known for is having a pretty low rake compared to the rest of the country.
Yeah, I was talking with, I don't want to rehash the whole conversation, but John Kim was on the show just on Tuesday, and we were talking about how I'm from Northern California, and when I play in the rooms here, there's no perks, huge rake. When you go to Vegas, even if you go to, you know, like Jed's card room 17 miles off the strip, you feel like you're treated like a king. So also you have the apps. Tell me a little bit about the apps, because people might, you know, there's a lot of people out there with smartphones and stuff like that. Is it just an extension of the website? Is it going to help them when they get on the ground in Vegas?
Definitely.
Okay. Tell me
definitely.
A little bit
about it. So currently we have
are they free of charge, or are they going to pay for it?
Yes. We have an All Vegas Poker app that's available for free on the for the iPhone and Android devices. Basically, it is All Vegas Poker in the palm of your hand. The apps do not have the same level, the same amount of information as what we have on the websites as far as all of the community dialogue and the forums and whatnot. At least not yet, they don't. But if you're looking for information on poker rooms or, you know, the ratings that players give the various poker rooms or tournament schedules, absolutely, it's everything you need in the palm of your hand. And we're in the process, actually, of adding new features to the All Vegas Poker app. We're also building a Poker Atlas app, and those should be released pretty soon, probably right around the World Series time frame. So, you know, currently, our app is, you know, best used for looking up information on rooms, calling the rooms really easily. You know, we have all their contact info in. So if you're looking up information on, like, Caesar's Palace, for example, You can see, you know, all the reviews that people write about him. You can see the cash games running. You can see the tournament schedule. And then if you want to call the room to put your name on the board to sit in a game, for example, you know, just push the button and it calls them. So
that's pretty sweet. That's very handy. Like super handy.
A lot easier than, you know, pulling out your laptop or your iPad at the table. That's for sure.
And it's free. It's free to download on either platform. That's great. Now the people can use that to help them with all their WSOP plans. I have a question for you and your WSOP plans. Are you going to be playing? Are you going to try to go for Bracelet Glory one more time?
Oh, without a doubt. No matter how little poker I play, I will always participate in the World Series of Poker. I don't know, you know, exactly what my schedule is going to look like. If I had to guess, I'd say I'd probably be playing in, you know, 5 to 8 events this year. Probably some of the, you know, my personal favorite events are the, you know, lower buy-in huge field events. So I'll probably play in a few of the $1,000 buy-ins, maybe some 1500s. And I definitely will not miss the main event.
Outstanding. John, where can let's get all the plugs out there. Where can people find you, follow you? What should they be doing? Everything John Friedberg.
Well, you know, definitely check out allvegaspoker.com. Download our apps on iTunes or Android. Check out thepokeratlas.com. And if you want to follow me personally, you're welcome to do that as well. I'm on Twitter at John Friedberg. No H, just John, J-O-N, Friedberg. And, that's it. You know,
outstanding. That's great. John, thanks so much for joining us today. Everyone, check out, of course, the Poker Atlas, All Vegas Poker. Follow John at John Friedberg. We'd love to have you back when the WSOP is in full swing. Give us an update. Hopefully, maybe by then you'll have bracelet number 2, John.
Let's hope so. And thank you so much, Jeff. I love your show. You're doing a great job. Keep up the good work, my man.
Thanks, John. Hey, have a great night.
You too. Thanks.
There he goes. It's John Friedberg. We are going to take a quick break, and then the king of the wombats, he's going to be here. Pete Lebrano. Pete's got a plan, and I have no idea what he has got planned for us. So we're going to bring him on and let him loose. You're listening to the Poker Gossip Show on Quad Jacks Radio.
Hey, this is Del Rock Show in the place to be. I listen to Quad Jacks Radio every Tuesday and Thursday because it's JW, better known as PKRGSSP. Now that's poker gossip with no vowels, but with all the top guests, including me.
We're back from the show. Thank you to my guest, John Friedberg. What a great guest, right? I always like talking to those guys who have a real good head on their shoulders. He's obviously got a great business sense. You're going to want to check out allvegaspoker.com. Well, my next guest, he almost doesn't need introduction to the Quad Jacks crowd, but just in case you happen to be brand new to the show, he's well known around these parts for his invaluable contribution to the Quad Jacks Black Friday emergency broadcast. He's also the poker professional who first claimed that they took our fucking jobs, bro. I want to welcome to the show, Pete Got a Plan, Peter Lebrano, King of the Wombats. Is he here?
What's up, Jeff?
How are you, Pete? Great to have you on the show, sir.
Good to be here. Good to be here.
The Wombat Nation, you know, they go crazy anytime they hear your voice, and of course, I'd be remiss if I didn't bring up the fact that, of course, here we are, Pete, 1 year after Black Friday. I just want to get your thoughts. How's the job search going?
I feel like I'm working a part-time job.
Are you grinding still? Because I see it looks like you might be playing the Mergements.
Yeah, I'm still stuck on that Mergements grind.
I'm actually getting out
more often. Actually, I cut it down to like maybe 3 to 4 days a week. I've been playing on Merge, playing a couple of cash games locally 2 days a week, and getting some live MTTs in also. So I've been getting out of the house a little more often nowadays.
How do you like it? I mean, I know that that pre Black Friday you were definitely online grind, and now you got to actually just get as I've said in the past, you're seeing 30 hands an hour. You got to be going crazy.
Yeah, it's terrible, to be honest with you. And I play for obviously small amounts of money because there's not big prize pools anymore. So it's really hard to make money staying in the U.S. right now. So I'm pretty much deciding where to go after I'm done with the WSOP this summer. I'm probably going to get up and get out of here.
So I saw that you're going to grind the WSOP. Are you going to go to Vegas for the whole summer?
Well, no, actually, I can't this year. I have a couple of business opportunities that's going on that I'm not going to be able to be out there for the whole summer, but I am going to be out there for the main event and a couple of prelims before that. So I'll be out there for probably like 4 or 5 events this year instead of my last year's 30 events, you know?
Oh, wow. Yeah, killing it with 30 events. But you've also mentioned that you're thinking about leaving the United States. Where are your places on – what's your short list on where you might move to?
Short list is either between Canada and Costa Rica. I'm pretty much coin flipping. I'm not sure yet. You know, I have multiple people telling me about both places, and I'm up in the air. I just can't make a decision. I'm going to give it another month or so. I've been looking at places in both areas. There's good and bads to both ends, you know. It's just hard to make a decision. It's, you know, it's my life.
Yeah, for sure. You're an East Coast guy, right? So you're used to the cold weather.
Yeah, so Canada ain't gonna be such. It wouldn't be so bad for me. But I also the nice weather, you know, going to Costa Rica wouldn't be so bad either, you know.
Yeah. Have you ever been down to Costa Rica?
No, I haven't actually, but I've heard good things.
Yeah, for sure. A lot of the kids like it down there.
Yeah, they're having fun.
So are you able to scratch out a living on Merge? I mean, how's the software? What's your opinion of it? Are you able to get cash outs? Like, what's your experience like, you know, doing what you got to do on Merge?
Yeah, I have pretty much no issues with it, except besides that I don't have a chat. But now Merge is all right. Software's all right. It's pretty funny. You can make faces and all this other stuff, and you can write troll and things like that. And you can write that you're a streaker and the guy runs across the screen naked. They got some cool shit going on, you know?
That sounds good.
Yeah, but whatever. It is what it is for now. It's the only place you can play, you know? If someone told you could only go to McDonald's and eat, you go there every day, right? You know, that's it. It is what
yeah,
it is.
Yeah, definitely.
You know? I have no choice. It's either here, cake, or both Bovadas, which is terrible. And I'd rather just sit here. Pretty much they're growing, expanding every day. From when I started a year ago until now, it's definitely blown up the site. And it's going in the right direction. I really can't complain.
We all know that you crush online. So what are the players like on Merge? Is it just a soft for you?
Oh, they're terrible. They're just terrible. If I can show you hand histories, we would laugh about them. These guys just have no idea. I look up guys and they're down thousands of dollars and they just keep going. I love it, you know. They must be like retired guys, some of them, you know. They just got money to blow.
So,
time.
Yeah, definitely. You know, because, well, you know how it is with poker, right? It's a bit of an addiction. You got to get it however you can get it. And so, you know. If they're going to do Merge, they're going to do Merge, especially if they've got the money to blow.
Exactly.
But I was going to say, do you follow – I mean, obviously, you're kind of a pivotal personality to the whole Black Friday movement. I mean, if the Quad Jacks Black Friday emergency broadcast, as well listened to as it was, like by thousands of people, man, Pete got a plan. You were right there. You coined it. People talking about wombats. I still got people who follow me on Twitter. They got wombat in their name, you know, like, so it's all over that. Do you follow the legislation talk? Are you up to date on that?
I read with that once in a while on 2+2, you know, what's going on. I follow people on Twitter that have, you know, good information. I see what's going on pretty much, but it's not happening as fast as I'd like it to be honest with you.
I got a real tough question for you, Pete. Sure. This is going to take some thought. If you could, would you give up 18 wheelers if you could play on Stars again? would you give up the 12 gauge if you had it? It's like 12 gauge for Full Tilt or 18 wheelers for Stars. You got to give one up. How, you know what I mean? Like, would you do it?
at this point, yeah, for my livelihood, yeah, I guess money's more important than some pop, but traveling out of the country for my job is just, my brain is just like, it's disgusting. And I feel like, I don't know, I'm being robbed for my rights. I don't know. Just, it drives me crazy that I would have to, like, just get up and go to earn a living, which is really sickening. But, yeah, I'm thinking about doing it. I pushed it off for over a year now, and, you know, I'm getting by. You know, I'm not touching my savings. I'm not going broke, you know. It's just that I'm not making what I was making. I'm not happy with it, so it's time to make a move.
But you're also are you a stock guy too? Do you dabble in the stock market?
I make money gambling on sports. I make money in stocks. I'm an entrepreneur. You know, I'm not scared. The DOJ took my main job, but you know, I'm not scared. I'm out there. I spread my money around.
Do you? I'm definitely interested in your stock analysis if you have it. And I want to know, everybody wants to know, outside of poker, dude, what's going on with Apple stock? Does Pete say buy Apple stock?
No, I don't say buy Apple stock.
Well, too high?
I would say stay off of it, wait for everybody to sell it and then buy it. Because it's definitely going to have a downswing at one point.
So do you dabble in the stock market like on a daily basis, or do you just kind of play sports, grind the merchants, and get out of the house? I mean, is that how you're like how it's mostly coming together for you?
Like my daily schedule is I get up, I check out the lines, I see what's going on in sports, and as I'm drinking my coffee and smoking my 12 gauge, I'm reading over the stocks that I own and seeing what's the deal. You know, am I up? Am I down? And see if there's some couple of stocks that I'm looking at that if they're at the target price that I'm looking for to buy them, you know, I'm just looking at my daily stuff. And then after that, I pretty much get up, I exercise, I do a little run on the treadmill. I eat my egg whites with some coffee, and that's it. I get to work.
Are you a health guy?
No, I started to eat right and to run and exercise because I ain't a health guy. That's the whole thing. And I'm trying to do the right thing with myself. You know, I want to be around to spend my millions.
When you bet sports, are you do you bet on your favorite teams?
I try not to.
And are you a Jets guy?
No, I'm a Giants guy. That's why I made a ton of money the last few years on the Super Bowls.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. I think I heard that. You know, a friend of the show, Dave Tuckman. I don't know if you know Dave Tuckman. He's from Live at the Bike, and he does some commentary for the ESPN. He's also a huge Giants guy, and he made a ton of money on the Giants at the Super Bowl as well.
Yeah, I actually loved it. I actually just made another bet the other day. I took my money from the Super Bowl on Bravada and cash got a check, and I had like whatever it was, I think $2,700, and I left like $200 in there. And the other day I took the Knicks versus Boston with that two and change minus three, and I doubled up. So I haven't made a bet in a while. Nice. You know, I've been so busy. I finally doubled up my money on there.
I'm here in San Francisco, and you know, we just picked up a couple of Giants. We picked up Mario Manningham, and
yeah.
Is it? Did we pick up Brandon Jacobs as well?
Or yeah, I think so. I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. So because we lost you in the NFC Championship game.
that's what people usually do. You know, you get beat by someone, you go out and get their plays.
Yeah, definitely. So let's talk a little bit about your WSOP run, both last year and this year. The whole Black Friday, it's just cut into you so much. You have some business opportunities, but what do you think your poker intake is going to be this summer? I know you said four or five events, but will you still be grinding there on the East Coast and just not unable to make it out here? Or
yeah, I'm going to be grinding on the East Coast. I'll probably play a little bit at the Borgata for whatever events they have during the summer. And I have Parks coming up here next month also. There's a couple of things I'm going to grind out live. But yeah, I can't spend the whole 2 months out there this year. Right. I have a couple of things going on, so it's just rough. I would die to, because the last 3 years straight I've been out there pretty much the whole summer. And I even came back for November 9, two out of the last 3 years.
Oh,
stayed
yeah?
out there for a month. Yeah, I love Vegas. I lived out there for 2 years, about 6 years ago. I love it there. You know, I eventually will be living there full time, hopefully within the next 6 months to a year.
Now, you like you said earlier, you're starting to play live. You're playing some live tournaments where I know that for a guy like you, that's got to be super slow. How do you find the play of the modern-day live local grinder?
It's terrible, honestly. It really is. It really is terrible. People smell. People are arrogant, rude. I don't know. It's from soup to nuts. The live action is just terrible. You know, I can't handle it anymore. It's like driving me up a wall. But whatever, I do what I got to do. You know, it's just, this is what I choose to do for a job. I got to stick with it, and that's it.
It's crazy, right? When you're, when you're playing live, the unkempedness of some of these players, like, it's just that they go out in public like this, and then you are forced to sit next to them for 7 hours at a time if you have a table that's not going to break.
Right. And then how about if you get stuck with a guy that wants to talk to you and his breath is kicking, you know, like, and he's next to you and he just wants to talk. He's like, you know, this is what he does. He's stuck in the house. He don't talk to his wife for 6 hours, 12 hours at a time. And now he wants to talk, but his breath smells like he didn't brush his teeth for a month. So now this guy's in one ear. Then you got the dealer that smells like ass in the other ear. It's like you have no place to run. You're like stuck between a rock and a hard place. But whatever, you're there making money. So you know what? You put your nose into your shirt a little. You know, you bust out the, what do you call it, Q-tips, clothespin. You put it on your nose and you suck it up a little. You know, take it on the chin, as they say.
Yeah, it sounds like you're stuck in the one seat in that scenario, right?
Yeah, stuck in the one seat, which I hate, you know. I'm more like, I like the 4-5-6 area.
Have you found that you've had any success this year playing these live locals?
I must have played about 12 events this year live, maybe 14. I'm not positive. I haven't cashed a one.
Really?
Really? That good? I bubbled three events with the nuts twice. I had aces and kings lose to jacks or tens twice on the bubble. Of the both events, that would probably be both decent that I played. And I have no luck live lately. But whatever it is, what it is, you know, it's variance. And I'm going to turn it around. Last year, I played 28 or 30 events, and I only cashed in two, you know. It is what it is, you know, and it's not easy.
It's not. Tournament poker is such a grind, and, you know, you can continually get it in good, and that's all you can really hope for is getting it in good.
Yes, sir.
I was going to ask, I don't know if you know or if you've been following. I know you said you followed a little bit, but, you know, there's been rumblings right now of this of Full Tilt maybe coming back, like the new Full Tilt and the Toppy group. I'm sure you've said it on the air in the past, but just for the new audience, are you stuck on Full Tilt right now?
No, I'm good. I don't really. I made my most money there, to be honest with you. I'm just sick to my stomach with those people. I would never do any business there again.
No, I mean, are they holding, like?
Do I have money there? Yeah, a couple of thousand. They got of mine.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Howie's wiping his ass with my bankroll.
Yeah, everyone's. Well, you know, he and Ferguson are actually taking turns back and forth.
Back and forth. Yeah, they're sharing it. Yeah, that. They got me for some money. They got a lot of my friends for money, and I'm pretty much disgusted with them. I have a beautiful Full Tilt jersey that I'm in the process of taking the both L's off and making it FU Tilt Poker, the jersey, because it's so nice. How can I not wear it? It says Pete got a plan on the back. It's got my number.
You got a custom jersey out from Tilt?
Yeah, and I fucking love it, and I can't even wear it. You know, it's disgusting. So I got sent it out, and I'm having the guy take the L's off.
Oh, that's pretty sweet. That's gonna be great. Yeah. You'll tweet a picture of that, right?
Of course. I will definitely tweet a picture of that as soon as it comes back.
Now, Pete, do you have a family where you are? Are you a single man? Like, what's your situation for you moving? Like, who are you leaving behind when you move?
I grew up, born and raised in New York, so I'm leaving pretty much everybody behind. Yeah. You know, but I really probably would mainly take a few of my family members with me, that my closest family, and move with me, and that's it. You know, my couple of my friends are also looking to move, so I'd be taking a couple of my friends and my close family with me, and that's it.
Wow. I mean, it's still going to be such a culture shock. Do you know anyone in either spot that you're thinking about going to that's going to kind of shepherd you into that?
I know a couple people out in Canada that are playing. I know a couple people out in Costa Rica that are playing, but I know people that did it already and came back, and it's pretty much, I'm not scared to do it. It's not a big deal. You know, I feel like, and it's going to be an adventure for me. You know, I did adventures my whole life. What's another one, you know?
Yeah, for sure. And what's the, let's say you went to Canada. I'm just thinking out loud, like, what's the travel time? Would you even do, like, there's some pros out there who, some pros spend time in Mexico and they go back and forth between Mexico and LA. Could you do that with Canada? Would you keep your place and like go grind for 5 days and come back for weekends? Or are you just thinking about like going, you know, a double middle finger USA, I'll see you when you get your shit straight and then you bounce?
No, I'll probably go flop back and forth.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's probably the best way to do it, in my opinion. And people that are doing it, it's like, you know, 6 to 8, 10 months already, you know, I don't know how they're lasting that long. I would be dying to get home. I know when I go away to just like to Mexico or Cancun, something like that, I'm dying to get home, you know. When I get home, I can't wait to get out of here by the seventh day. So I don't know how they do it for months on months. You know, I could probably only do it a month or two at a time and then run back.
It's quite a grind, and you know, like I had said, you're a bit of the you're a voice for the post Black Friday malaise type, you know, like that feeling of anger that's there. There's been a lot of discussion in the media about who's to blame. Is the DOJ to blame? Are PokerStars, are Full Tilt and UB to blame for their shady banking practices? Do you have an opinion on that? If you had to direct your anger somewhere, do you direct it at all of them, or where do you direct it?
I probably would direct it. Honestly, the DOJ is just, they're just greedy. They just want money, you know? In my opinion, these wombats, if they didn't get greedy, everything would be still going. So I feel more like I place the blame on, like, UB, Full Tilt type people, you know? I feel like if they didn't get greedy, we would still be rocking and rolling to this day.
Definitely. But what about the fact that, like, when you think about Full Tilt, we would definitely be rocking and rolling, but they were obviously mismanaging money. Like, there could be the fact that they could have been spending your money anyway, and that, you know, maybe, do you think that there could be a better future for online poker on the horizon?
I pray to God.
Yeah.
You know, in my opinion, I think they'd be stupid not to regulate it. You know, so much is a $1 billion-a-year industry, and you got to be dumb to not take your money off the top. And everybody, nobody minds giving the government their money. We're giving them their money our whole life. Let's give them their cut, and let's get on with business. It's pretty simple math.
Do you still have a lot of the fans that you accumulated over Black Friday, over the emergency broadcast? They still follow you and keep in touch with you? The whole Wombat Nation, all the brown pros that you signed in that short amount of time.
Yeah, I've been in contact with everybody. The Wombat Nation is a good group of people. You know, I do in my life, in my private life, I keep everybody around me good people. And this is what the Wombat Nation is. We're a family, we're a community of good people, and that's it.
I just can't forget, Pete, hearing you on the radio. The Brown Pros, the Wombat Nation, the whole thing. You know, I love having you on the show. I'd love to have you back when you go to the WSOP or anytime you'd like. You know, you're one of those characters, so charismatic. We love to hear from you. Where can people find you? They can, of course, follow you on Twitter. How can they keep up to date with everything that Pete's got going on?
Well, you can pretty much follow me at Pete Got a Plan on Twitter. You can write some comments to me. I'm the one reading all the comments on the Wombat Nation. So send in your comments. I'll read them.
Great. And so for the time being, they can find you on Merge. Sometimes they'll be up heads up against you on Merge. Also at the parks, at the Borgata. Fucking brush your teeth, right?
Yeah, please, guys. Oh, there's one dealer that I got a picture of in my phone. You just got to practice avoidance if you run into this guy.
and then we're going to get you for just a few events at the WSOP, including the main, though. Maybe
yes,
this is
sir.
The year. Wouldn't that be sweet? You take down the main, and you don't have to move, dude.
This is good. This is the year. I feel it.
This is the year.
I can feel
it. Pete got a plan. The plan is we're going to make the October 9 and take the whole thing down, and that way you can stay in your beloved New York, and you just get giant season tickets and crush.
All right. Well said, Jeff.
All right, buddy.
All right. Pete, take care, Jeff. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
We'll talk to you again super soon.
Definitely, definitely. Take care, Wombat Nation.
Take care. There he goes. Pete got a plan. Man, what a great guy. Pete Lebrano. He's, you know, one of the first voices of the Black Friday broadcast that we know and love. Just a little side note about Pete. You know, I was talking with Marco on Sunday regarding the Black Friday broadcast. Now, we know that Black Friday was bad and still bad, and we don't like it, and we don't like being able to play, not be able to play poker in our own homes in the United States. It feels bad, but there's a little sense of nostalgia for those of us who listen to hours upon hours of that broadcast. And man, when you just hear Pete's voice, you just feel good. You just feel good. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to be right back to wrap this baby up and send you on your weekend. You're listening to Quad Jacks Radio. Hey, what did we learn today? We learned all sorts of great things from so many great guests. Of course, Pete got a plan. Pete Lebrano, thank you so much. King of the Wombat Nation. He taught us that we need to brush our teeth before we go play poker, as well as we need to eat egg whites. Egg whites, brush your teeth. Pete Lebrano, thank you so much for being on the show. What did we learn from John Friedberg? I think we definitely learned that we don't want to let the game pass us by. It's a very expensive proposition to do that, as well as anything that you want to know, you can find at allvegaspoker.com. And what did you learn from me, your host, Jeff, your humble host? I think we learned that no one likes a tough guy. And I'm very uncomfortable being put in situations where someone's going to punch me in the face. Just that and the fact that I can talk just a little bit too long. So I won't make the same mistake right now. I want to thank you all so much for listening. We're always working on improving the show, and your contributions and comments are more than welcome. You can follow me on Twitter. It's at PKRGSSP, at Poker Gossip with no vowels. I'm so sorry for that. As well as my email address is that same BS. It's PokerGossip, PKRGSSP, at gmail.com. Love to hear from you. I hope you enjoyed the show. I want you to have a great weekend. Go out there and run good, and we'll see you next week.